Hey, welkom allemaal bij een nieuwe LinkedIn Live waar we het vandaag gaan hebben over, uiteraard over leadopvolging, over eigenlijk verkoop en hoe worden we daar beter in. Want namelijk verkoop is gewoon belangrijk, zeker nu, en leadopvolging in het algemeen was natuurlijk al belangrijk, maar in dit coronatijdperk is het nog veel belangrijker. Dus we gaan allemaal een half uur praten met Simon Bouquet, een sales trainer uit de UK die ontzettend veel ervaring heeft hoe dat aan de andere kant van de plas gaat. Op welke manier volgen hun lead op trainen ze hun salesmens al daar om te komen tot een betere conversie. Nou, en misschien is het ontzettend leuk om te kijken wie er op dit moment aanwezig is, wie er live zijn. Geef een like, zeg even wie je bent, wat je doet en dan gaan we zo meteen beginnen met Simon. Maar eerst even nog wat anders. In die zin van, we doen veel sales meetings. Hè? En vooral tegenwoordig via Zoom. En vanochtend had ik weer een sales meeting met een aantal verkopers over de leadopvolging. En die leadopvolging gaat goed. Weet je wel, we scoren goed. Weet je wel, we maken veel afspraken in de showroom. Maar we maken te weinig afspraken in de showroom met mensen die zeggen, joh, hartstikke leuk en aardig. Ik wil nog niet naar de showroom komen. Wat is mijn inruilauto waard? He, dat is eigenlijk het bezwaar om niet te komen. En daarop gaan heel veel verkopers zeggen, joh, dat snap ik, dat begrijp ik. Ik heb wat foto's van u nodig via de WhatsApp en dan kan ik u een prijs geven. Maar ja, dat is natuurlijk niet waar het om gaat. Bij leadopvolging gaat het erom dat we daadwerkelijk ervoor zorgen dat we afspraken maken, ook met mensen die graag eerst een indicatie willen hebben voor hun inruilauto. Nou, en wat we hebben gezegd is van, joh, hoe vraag je dat nou? He, hoe vraag je nou een klant die niet wil komen bij jou in de winkel om toch te komen tot de winkel? En natuurlijk gaat dat via een script, via een model waarvan je zegt van, joh, daar heb ik succes mee. En dat succesmoment is natuurlijk wel belangrijk. Maar als je vraagt om een afspraak, moet je er altijd voor zorgen. Altijd voor zorgen dat je er een voordeel bij brengt. Wat is het voordeel voor de klant om een afspraak te maken? Dus je pakt de telefoon, je doet de opening. De klant zegt, ja, ik heb wel even tijd. En jij zegt, fijn, dank u wel. De vraag die ik heb is, u wil graag een taxatie hebben voor uw inruilauto. Klopt dat? Nou, de klant zegt, ja. Nou, daarvoor maken we bij autobedrijf ABC graag een afspraak hier bij ons in de showroom, opdat we weten dat we dan het beste voorstel kunnen maken. Wanneer kunt u langskomen? Nou, en dan zeggen de meeste mensen, ja, ho, 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 eens even. Zo snel gaat het niet. Ik wil eerst weten wat mijn auto waard is. Dus je hebt dan een keer gevraagd, dan zeg je, joh, dat snap ik, dat begrijp ik. Maar we weten allebei dat we pas met elkaar tot overeenstemming komen als we het beste voorstel kunnen doen voor beide kanten. Dat klopt toch? Ja, zegt de klant. Nou, daarvoor maken we graag een concrete afspraak hier bij ons in de showroom. Wanneer kunt u langskomen? Dus dat is de tweede keer dat ik erom vraag. De klant zegt, joh, u begrijpt me verkeerd. Ik wil geen afspraak. Ik wil alleen maar komen op het moment dat ik weet wat mijn auto waard is. En dan zeg je, dat snap ik helemaal. Veel van onze klanten willen ook eerst weten waar ze aan toe zijn. Laten we dan even van de gebaande wegen afgaan. En laten we op dat moment even wat foto's met elkaar uitwisselen. Zodat ik weet waar we over praten. Als ik alle informatie van u heb, ik zal u zo meteen een mailtje sturen met de informatie die ik nodig heb. Wanneer heeft u dan tijd voor mij om samen met mij telefonisch te spreken over het voorstel wat we zouden kunnen doen? Is dat vanmiddag om 4 uur of om 5 uur? Dus je maakt een concrete afspraak met de klant. En dat doen we vaak niet. Dus de eerste 2 keer vragen om de afspraak, dat doen we vaak niet. Maar op het moment dat we dan bepalen dat we toch op afstand een voorstel gaan maken, dan gaan we dat voorstel maken en dat gaan we mailen. En daarna gaan we met de klant bellen. En daar gaat het fout. Want de klant ziet de informatie, ziet €8.000 staan. Heeft net op gaspedaal zitten te kijken en zag €12.000 staan. En denkt het zal wel en neemt de telefoon niet meer op. En daar gaat het mis. Dus je moet een vervolgafspraak maken. En daar gaan we dus ook over hebben met Simon. En Simon komt er nu bij. En Simon, welcome to our LinkedIn Live.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me, Paul. It's nice to be there with you, but over this environment, so jumping on a plane to come and see you.
Yeah. It should be better, right? In a plane, yes. In a pub with a pint, etc. And then talk about the online automotive space.
We could talk forever because I know how passionate you are about the automotive space. And I don't know how long you got scheduled, but we might go on for a bit here.
Yeah, we can talk for hours and we know each other for now longer than 5 minutes, yes, but yes. We're not, but we can talk for hours now on this topic, right?
Oh, yes.
Hey, Simon, can you introduce yourself to our audience? Who is Simon and what is your passion in life and in the business?
Well, I just want to say thank you to your audience to listen to this. So I'm an Australian. I grew up, and I hope my accent is easy for you to understand. I did the backpacking thing in 95, traveling around the world, because we don't have a lot of culture in Australia. So we have to go and look for it. I got as far as the UK, and I ran into my wife, and I got stuck in the UK. I don't know if stuck's the right word, but I've been here so long, I've even bred to English people now. So I'm well and truly here. But my background, when I was 17, I was a cadet salesperson. I started the motor trade, and I still get that buzz from the motor trade they got from when I was, I'm 47 now, so 30 years ago, I still get that same buzz from the industry. I still love it.
Yeah. And what is your business now?
So I run a sales training company called Simcoe Training, based in the UK. And we work primarily in the UK, through Europe bits, lots in Ireland, and of course, my native home country, Australia. We still do lots of work there, as you would imagine. I like to get home when I can.
I can imagine it. But what is the purpose of training salespeople in the UK? Is that way different than especially our market, or is training salespeople not that important?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, people, I believe, are still people at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. There are cultural differences, and people ask all the time, is the Australian, New Zealand market different to the Irish market? But the reasons why people feel like they've got a good deal, the reasons why people feel like they're going to buy or not buy a particular model, or buy or not buy from a particular salesperson, that doesn't really change much. Sure, there's cultural differences, but Paul, I personally believe there's three sales in any sale. You still have to sell yourself first, the product second, and then the deal and the numbers. And you still have to sell yourself in any culture. You still have to then sell the product and make sure it's right before the deal. And I still see that from when I started all those years ago to now, the top salespeople are brilliant at selling themselves first, then selling the product before you get the deals. The poor salesperson still wants to go into where do we need to be, what price, where do we need to be. And even if they get the number, get the deal, they've bought the business. It's probably not the best. So, training is still important, I think, in any country, any culture around the world there.
No, so we are in Holland, and especially my and the company, we are doing a lot of training and content about lead follow-up, online leads to the dealership. What is your perspective in those areas? Is a lead follow-up done by a BDC, for example, or by salespeople?
Yeah, it's a great question. That question goes not just on follow-up, but how the initial inquiry comes through, how does it deal with. Mm-hmm. Here's my view, and we have clients that have an all different approaches. But if you have a BDC, a business development center, the better that business development center is at dealing with the inquiry, if they're sensational at it, it then has to be passed on to a sales team to take it on from there. Yeah. And whenever there's a pass, there's a chance of a fumble. Now, as an Australian, we would love rugby, okay? Now, rugby league would say, and you'd always say, hold on to the ball and take with it, because you pass it, you might fumble it. And that's what we're noticing. You get a great BDC center that deals with inquiry really well. It gets passed on to a salesperson that says, here we go, another call from the call center. Oh, this won't be a real lead. What's happened? So my view is, if you're going to have a BDC, you need to have a BDC that can continue the whole program from inquiry to deal and be able to price the customer's trade in, be able to get the numbers, and more importantly, ask for the business. Now, if you're going to have salespeople dealing with the inquiry, hey, listen, I don't believe we need to have BDC centers that's the internet department. It's just the internet department. You know what? The internet department now is called the sales department. It's the same thing. So I believe we need to turn all of our salespeople into that BDC. I think we need to turn our salespeople into understand how to deal with that inquiry. Now, again, there's two views there, and such a great question there. But I'm always concerned about the fumble that happens when you pass.
But that's the game change, because everybody is thinking, and a lot of dealerships in Holland were visiting one of the biggest dealerships in the UK, because they had a tremendous BDC, very successful. But if you crack the numbers, you're only getting more people in, more investment in, and the conversion rate will not be higher, because the transfer between the BDC and to the consumer is the hardest part of it all. If you train your salespeople better to follow up the leads in the first place, you don't need the BDC center for following up an easy task.
That I would say, we have clients who have BDCs and they are sensational, but I would argue they're sensational and they are getting a better hit rate because they're training those people.
Yeah.
The one advantage a BDC has is you have the people central together and manager can listen to what everything's happening. With call monitoring, it's so easy to monitor every single call in there. And I believe they're getting a better hit rate because it's measured better. It's measured. Now, listen, with your call drip program, we're a huge advocate of that. That gives you the ability to measure every single salesperson, if they're in a BDC center or not. So I think it's more about, not is it a BDC, is it salespeople? Because, you know, some people listen to this, I'm sure you'll have big dealer groups that it makes sense for them to do that, or independents that can't do that. It's such a great question, but my view would be every salesperson needs to make sure they know how to deal with that inquiry. And let's measure the guys. Let's actually make sure that we inspect what we expect.
Yeah, that was a quote which first came to me through Bill Whittemeyer, the partner of Elite One, the business development center in America with 1,500 agents. And he always saying to me, Paul, change the words, change the results. That's important. If you want a better end conversion, inspect what you want to expect from the different versions. How many calls, how many connections, how many appointments, how many appointment shows, and then end result will not surprise you. And suddenly in Holland, we see an end conversion of 8.9%, and it is a disappointment. It is a surprise, which actually doesn't have to be a surprise if you inspect the results.
Yeah, I learned that lesson very, very early on. I'm old enough in the motor trade to realize that we had what's called a bat phone. So when an inquiry comes, we just had one phone would ring, because if the inquiry on telephone went to the individual salespeople, you couldn't hear what was happening. It's before call recording. And I had a trainer, a man called Brian Milstead. I was a brand new sales manager, still learning the ropes. He said, actually, just put the up desk in your office. Really simple. Okay, and that way you'll hear every single inquiry. And it was just such a game changer, because I can remember sitting there thinking, I can't believe my top salesperson hasn't asked for an appointment there. I can't believe he doesn't know the spec on that car. And it just let me absolutely understand. Now, of course, with technology, we can do that so much easier nowadays, can't we?
Yeah.
But that was the lesson that I learned very, very early on.
Yeah, I know from the from your market, the UK market as a whole, there is also a big broker market, right?
Yes,
there are a lot of brokers into the market. Can you explain what the broker is doing in your market and why it's benefiting the consumer or benefiting the dealer, or is it an hyena, for example?
Yeah, it's a great, again, another great question that other markets really haven't, it's not as mature yet. With the brokers, the leasing companies out there, they're effectively been doing what the rest of the motor trade is just doing now because of COVID-19, and that's selling cars directly. You get some of the big broker companies like Leasing Options. We would know intimately brokers there that you've got Nationwide. What these guys are doing is they're speaking to all the dealers, all the manufacturers and finding out what sort of volume deals they can do. What they're then doing is speaking to all the different funders, and they might have 6, 7, 8 different funders, and have a look at the best funding option they can do. And they're selling vehicles through contract hire, and they're matching the right vehicle and the right funding option together. Yeah. They have their websites. And what I've learned so much about these places is it's all about transparency. They've got on the websites, you can drive an Audi Q5, 5 Series or whatever, on a contract hire payment of 3 payments up front, followed by 24, 36, 48. That's the figure. You can have it fully maintained or not. That's it. Now, what's important, Paul, listening to these the brokers out there, these leasing companies, they don't have a car to be able to show the customer. If the customer wants to see the car, they have to say, hey, you need to go to your dealer and have a look at it. Yeah. These companies, they have to buy the car from a dealer. So I've got to be honest with you. Sometimes we see them as the parasites of the industry.
Yeah.
Why are they there? If you speak to any dealers, and hey, this has been broadcast in the country we don't work with, I'd be some of my dealers we're working with say, no, they're the parasites of the business.
Yeah.
They might be. But tell you what, we've allowed them to do that.
Yes.
All these guys are doing is they're being absolutely sensational at getting the internet marketing right. Yeah. They've been absolutely sensational as measuring every single inquiry that comes in. Yeah. They've been absolutely sensational. They're training the people every time to actually build rapport with the customer, put the customer at ease and ask
by
for
phone, business. By phone.
All via phone.
Yeah.
The inquiry comes through on email. Okay, any digital inquiry. When I say email, I'm talking about lots of digital. But it always ends up to phone, okay? Hey, listen, if you've got dealers out there that think they can still email a quote and win the business, it's like faxing back. You remember the old fax machine? Okay, if you've got dealers think they can do that, I believe they're kidding themselves. Okay. This leasing company, one particular one, they have 120 people, salespeople in a room. They are taking inquiries. Absolutely. The amount of inquiries are sensational, but they measure their closing ratio. They measure until they stay in touch with people till they buy or die. But more importantly, once they have bought, they're great at saying, great, now listen, how many cars are there in your close circle of friends and family? Yeah. Okay. Of those, which is the next to change? Why do you say Auntie Joan? Oh, what does she drive? Listen, they're brilliant at doing what the dealer should do. So I got to tell you, you speak to any dealer in the UK market about the brokers, you'll get some resistance, quite rightly. Yeah. But
but they are doing what you are saying, what the dealers should be doing. And when dealers have, I don't want to say an easy job, because it is not an easy job in the first place. But in Holland, many brands like Volkswagen or BMW or Mercedes are going to be bought, are not going to be sold. And if you don't have that muscle prepared every day to selling instead of taking the orders, then you are getting lost by an entrepreneur who wants to get your business one way or the other. And then we are calling it like a broker, but that's always the market, what it should be. If you're not good at it, you need to be better at it, because otherwise somebody is taking your market, and it should be.
Yeah, it's the other thing these the brokers have had the ability to do. I suppose it's back to the question about BDCs and maybe why they're effective. But again, I believe technology can fix this gap. And this is that they have the ability to monitor 100% of the inquiries that come into the business. And they have the ability to monitor 100% of the outcome. And if someone hasn't purchased, they have the ability to do third-party follow-up and go back to them and say, hey, second base, why haven't they gone ahead with it? They have the ability to do that. A dealer, an independent dealer, might be sitting thinking, well, how do I do that? Because there can't be many dealerships that haven't got some sort of call recording as part of training in their businesses.
The biggest thing you are saying now is that a lead in a broker environment is not without obligation. There is an obligation to do it what they think it is right to do. A lead in a dealer environment has no obligation whatsoever. Do your thing, and if it's not, don't work out, that's fine either.
Please don't take the wrong way. There will be good brokers who are punching above their weight. Okay, and the Vanaramas of the world, Leasing Options is an incredible, great organization. They do very, very well. There will be brokers who are very poor and they're playing at it. I think there will be different levels. But the ones I see that are doing very well, they absolutely have that lead. There's ownership of the lead.
Yeah.
Okay, and when they're not allowing a salesperson to decide, they're a waste of space. But back to the point. All of your dealers will have call recording somewhere. But does the sales manager have the time to sit there and listen to every single inquiry that come into the business? Because a lot of the call recording software, if it's just generically recording everything, you have to listen to 8 hours of what's for lunch, what did the kids do at school today, what lingerie are you wearing tonight when I turn up, okay, to get to the sales inquiry that where the salesperson didn't say, hey, should we secure that for you, didn't qualify the customer. And that's why I'm loving your technology with CoolDrip. We have no axe to bone here. We don't sell CoolDrip. We're not involved with it. This is a different country. But this, it gives the dealer the ability to have every inquiry monitored the right way.
No, but we have to sell sales managers to listen to two calls a day, which has an opportunity in it, which was misled by the salespeople, and they are not listening to the calls because they are thinking it is too less of a job for them as a sales manager. They don't understand the role of a sales manager as a coach, as a sales trainer, making his salespeople every day better, but also accountable.
Yes. Yes, it's that accountability. And hey, listen, that's the job of a sales manager. The shortest job description that you could ever find for a sales manager is read your business card. Okay, it says sales manager. And just flip the words around, and that means manage the sale.
Yeah.
Manage the sale from start to finish and find out what's happened with that lead. That is the job. There's something that the people listening to this thinking, okay, how do I do this? And I don't want this to sound just like an advert for your company, but I love what you're doing. Something simple they can do. In the UK, we do something called a SIM check. And it comes from the airline industry. Very, very simple. I fly a little light aircraft. And I've got down our flying club, there's lots of airline pilots. And one particular man I speak to one day, he had to go through the simulator check. And that's every 6 months, they have to go into a simulator to make sure they can fly right. Now, they have a different issue. If they stuff up in their world, someone dies.
Yeah.
In our world, if we get it wrong, we just don't sell a car.
Yeah.
I can remember Dave, good friend of mine, getting very upset within his words about this young kid telling him he wasn't happy with the way he was landing in the simulator. Okay. And he said, whoa, I don't like this. Who's he think I am? He had 15,000 hours. He takes off and lands 3 or 4 times a day. And this training kid, in his words, wasn't happy with the way he was landing. They had an argument. They went and pulled the tapes of actual flights they did. He said, thank goodness he did. Because in one flight, he was 2 inches of doing a tail strike landing in Guernsey. Now, Paul, no one would have died, okay? It wasn't, but a $40 million plane, if you're the pilot and you did a tail strike in it, that would have been the end of his job with that airline. I would suggest the career. And what I learned from Dave, that he said, this is someone who had thousands of hours. He knew how to do it. But guess what? We all build up these bad habits slowly, bit by bit. So this is why I urge your sales manager to listen to this. Dealer principal, listen to this. Do what we do in our company. You don't need a company like ours to do this, but every 6 months we do a SIM check. It's not a mystery shop. There's a big difference. So we do a simulator check where it starts from a digital inquiry to see how they take the inquiry. From the digital inquiry, it goes to a phone inquiry to see how they make the appointment. We turn up, all recorded, and they sell us a car from start to finish. Through it, it's not like a mystery shop, because actually when they ask a trial closed question and it's not right, as in an airliner in a simulator, we say, stop, listen, you stuffed that one up, let's do it again. What should you do? No, that's not right. You haven't got commitment there, have you? We get to the end of it, and when they're going through the negotiation, we say, hey, Billy, you know you haven't actually asked for the business. Now, Paul, every time, almost every time, we get salespeople say, oh, I'd normally ask that. No, I'd normally ask that.
Yeah.
But they don't. Because, you see, we as humans, when we're under pressure, now in a flight simulator, when it's for their job, or when we're doing a sim check, when they're under pressure, we as humans revert to type. When we're under pressure, what comes out is what we naturally do. And they are under pressure when they do a sim check. And what happens is they revert to type, and you realize that they are just doing things that the management team never realized. I'll give you one for instance. It's one particular group we work with. Great group. Their top salesperson. I'll go backwards. Their brand new salesperson on a sim check stopped to do a handover on a demonstration drive in a bus lane of a dual carriageway. I went, whoa, hold on a second. You don't normally stop here, do you? He said, yeah, every time. Why? Well, that's where I was shown to do it. Right, who should you? The top guy. Great, we did a sim check on the top guy. Their top seller. Where did he stop? In the bus lane. Yeah. Everyone in this dealership, small dealership, they only had seven or eight people. They were all stopping in this bus lane because that's what everyone had done. So, guys, do a sim check. It's so easy to do. Jump in the car, okay? Record it. You don't have to go and buy all the technology we have. Use your iPhone, okay? Record it and say, sell me a car from start to finish. It'll be an eye-opener, because what your first mentor, I can't remember his name, inspect what you expect.
It's an eye-opener. Yeah, but also when you are doing your job for so long with the same people in your dealership, you're going to be blind for the spots which is obvious for somebody else.
So true.
But somebody, you need sometimes strange eyes, different eyes to let you see the faults you are making and what you can do better.
Yes. Yeah, it's so true. And it's what's right in front of you. I can't believe I've missed that all the time there, what I've done there.
And it's not on purpose, but somebody has to point you out the mistakes you are getting. And that's the one thing I learned so much from eBay, like an American company, reach your potential. Because I'm talking to a lot of salespeople, and they are saying, Paul, I have no problem at all with the lead follow-up. I say, okay, that's fine. If you don't want to learn, that's fine. I can learn somebody who is not learnable in a sense. Because I'm doing my numbers. I'm saying, okay, what is your number then? I have to sell 150 cars a year. For example, I said, okay, how do you come up with that number? Oh, that's at the 1st of January, we say we have to sell 150 cars. So if you're doing 160, I said, you did a great year. Yes, I did a great year. I said, but if I'm going to inspect what you expect, and I turn it over, and you're getting chances to sell at least 180 cars, are you still confident that you had a good year, or did you have a bad year? Then I said, no, I have a good year still, because I have to sell 150 cars. At the eBay platform, we are taught that if the potential is 180 and the budget was 150 and you are getting 165 on the board, you are still lacking 15 cars. Mm. And you need to reach your potential. If you have the chances to sell 180, you have to sell 180. That's the new benchmark.
Yeah.
Because everything else is history.
Yeah. There's something that we do in our company, and I'd urge everyone listen to this. Actually, probably 6, maybe 7 years ago, it was a bit of a game changer in our business. And that's what we call our personal best targets. And it's really simple. Paul, if you come and started working for us as one of our salespeople or one of our consultants, one of our coaches, it's very, very simple. Whenever you've achieved for the month more than you ever have, I don't mind telling you this, you'll get a one-off bonus of £1,000. Okay. Mm-hmm. I don't know what that is in euros at the moment. It's all over the place, but
it's almost the same, right?
Yeah. Okay. Now, to get that next month, our salesperson just has to beat what they bought in. Now, the beauty of that is, can they turn around and say to me, that's not achievable? Well, you've done it last month. Do it next month. Okay. All you got to do is beat it by £1 and I'll be happy. To them get their personal bonus the third month, they just have to beat it again and beat it again. And what I love about that and why it works for
I like that one.
Please put in your business. It works so well because I used to give targets to my people. That's what you expect. But that is an I've given it to them. And people are always going to say, well, who's they think he is? If my pay's that. But because it's personal best, okay, they're fighting against themselves. Now, Paul, I'm not a golfer, okay? Are you a golfer at all, sir?
No,
me neither. But they tell me in that game, okay, that you're trying to beat yourself most of the time anyway. At the moment, I'm trying to run, okay, because I have to iron my shirt over a wok to get the right shape. So I need to lose the beer belly. And I've got a desire to maybe do a marathon. I'm 47 now. I'm thinking I've got to do it before I get too much older. And speaking about lots of people running a marathon, so many times they're trying to beat themselves. Yeah. It's their personal best. Now, in our business, I get managers saying, but what if you start someone brand new and actually they get it 12 months in a row? And every time I say, I hope so, because 12 months in a row, they've grown their business 12 months in a row. Now,
it makes so much sense because when you're playing a video game like a Formula One game, and you practice the round and you hit your personal best, then you see in the background yourself in that same lap, right? And you're trying to overtake yourself. And that makes perfectly sense.
It's so true. And again, I'm hoping some sales managers listen to this and think, right, I'm going to do that. Let's put that in place. It's now, again, personal best doesn't have to just be on the number of units. You can use it on any part of the business you want to improve. With regards to your world, if the appointments, the sales they're taking from the inquiry and the follow-up, if they're achieving something like 12%, great, listen, let's get that up to 15%. Let's get that up to 16%. If it is the sale of your paint and fabric protection, you could do it on any parts of the business there. And it really is that that's for me, that's internal motivation as well as external motivation.
We have the sim and we have take your personal best, right?
Yeah.
To take home for this weekend.
Paul, there's something else. So you just broke up a bit there. I know this is live and that sometimes it's it just broke up there. But you're talking about the Formula One racing game. And I imagine Max Verstappen is someone that a lot of your listeners would have loved this weekend. I would be a Lewis fan, okay, but where I now live. But I want to tell your listeners about this, about top performers. I was training someone when I was just a brand new trainer, and he was a steward at Silverstone Racecourse. Mm-hmm. Now, with the Formula One drivers, they all came in normally on the Wednesday before the race weekend. Mm-hmm. There's a man called Michael Schumacher. Now, this was going back a few years. He turned up on the Monday before any other driver. The guy I trained was a steward, had the job of taking them around the track because they weren't set up with it. And Michael Schumacher stopped at every single corner and sat down on the corner. And the steward was looking at him. And about the sixth corner, Michael felt like he had to say something. He said, this is just the height I'm at when I'm in the car, so I just want to get the perspective where it is. So, okay. He walked to another corner and he started picking up little stones and little rocks and flicking it off the corner. He said, well, this was the Tuesday, Monday or the Tuesday. The race is not till Sunday, okay? But he said, it's the small attention to detail. So I naively said, that's why he ended up being 7-time world champion.
Yeah, but it's not by coincidence. It's not because you have always the best car. Like Lewis Hamilton, we love to beat him with Max, of course.
Yes.
He has the best car for 7 years, but Bottas had the same car for 4 years and did nothing.
Albon had exactly the same car last year and couldn't do anything with it, with the Red Bull. Hey, but listen, when I said this guy, I imagine that's before Michael was, that's why he's 7-time world champion. He turned around and said, no, he was already the 6-time world champion when he did this. He probably knew that track more than anyone else. He still took the time to go and do that before any other driver. And listen, that's what top car salespeople do. Don't they work hard at it?
Preparation and execution. Simon, thank you so much for this opportunity to speak to you, to getting to know you more about Sim, about taking your personal best as a game changer, as a new potential. That's your new height. Come over for a best month ever to perform over that. I did that with my marathons. I run 7 marathons, and the first one was actually the best one. So you have to train actually. Yeah, because the other one, I didn't train at all. So training is very important. So the last question I want to ask you, when dealers in Holland want to reach out to you, what's the best way to reach out to you?
The easiest way is LinkedIn, okay? LinkedIn is what we do. So it's just Simon Bokert. And as an Aussie, I have to say this. You'll see up beside my name there, it's got a UK flag. My brothers would be laughing so much at that. So remember, there's an Australian flag we would normally put there. I do live in the UK now. That's Simon Bokert on LinkedIn. You can find us at Simcoe Training. Go and have a look at our online training. There's a whole lot of stuff there for free if your dealers want it. We give away part of our sales fitness program. There's so much content they can get for free. It's been a pleasure. It's been great talking to you.
Thank you, Simon. En dat maakt ook het einde van deze nieuwe LinkedIn Live op de vrijdagmiddag. Ik hoop dat jullie er wat aan hebben gehad en dat het zinvol was. Hebben jullie nog vragen? Hebben jullie nog opmerkingen? Laat het ons weten via de geëikte kanalen. En dan zie ik jullie graag een volgende keer weer. Tot zover een weekend. Volgende week dinsdag. Een fijne Koningsdag. Tot ziens.